Hi, I'm Mihaela Blenda, Annual Program Manager on SQL Server team.
Hi, I'm Travis. I'm also a PM on the SQL Server team.
Today, we're going to look at several scenarios where availability groups can be used for read scale capabilities in SQL Server vNext.
Hold on. I thought availability groups were for high availability.
Yes, but in addition to bringing together the best-in-class HA capabilities, availability groups is a comprehensive solution that offer scaling solutions as well.
All right. Let me show you.
Let me show you how, and also highlight the enhancements we have in SQL Server vNext.
Okay.
In a typical database application, there are multiple clients running various type of workloads against the database. There are OLTP workloads, analytics, reporting, and so on. Sometimes the workloads will hit bottlenecks due to resource constraints. In this case, the customer will want to free up those resources so to increase the throughput for OLTP workloads or to achieve higher performance and scale for the read-only workloads. And this can be achieved by creating a group of replicated databases and offset the read-only workloads to the secondary replicas. And that's exactly what availability group is. You can configure one or multiple secondary replicas to accept read-only work traffic and free up resources on the primary databases. The clients will connect directly to the secondary databases, or the customer can configure a read-only routing list, and the primary will forward the connection request to each of the secondary in the routing list in a round-robin fashion for optimal load balancing.
All right, so this is great. I got read-only scale out. I can offload my read-only workloads off of my OLTP database and get faster throughput for both my OLTP and reporting. So lots of times with these reporting things or read-only workloads, you want to distribute that data all over the world so that people can get local access to that data wherever they are. Can always-on availability groups help with that?
Definitely. And the solution for that is to use distributed availability groups. In addition to offloading the read-only workloads from the primary to the secondary replicas, now the data is closer to the source of the read workloads. So you have less network latency, and you have dedicated resources for higher read throughput.
So I see on this chart here that we've got a large number of databases. How many of these can I actually have?
Well, a single data distributed availability group pretty much doubles the number of secondary replicas that you can have. Mm-hmm. If customer wants increased scaling, they can daisy chain multiple availability groups, or they can create two distributed availability groups from the same primary availability group. So they have infinite scaling at one,
wow.
Presumably.
Okay, infinite scale. You heard it here. All right, so this is awesome. I've got my read-only workload, my analytics and my reporting, they're offloaded to read-only replicas now. And my OLTP workload is going to be faster too because I've got it all dedicated to one server now. What other kinds of workloads can I offload to these read-only replicas?
In addition to analytics, reporting, or any type of read-only workload that can run on secondaries, mm-hmm. we can also run backups or DBCC checks for again, offloading workloads from the primary to get better performance.
I see. Awesome. Okay, so always-on availability groups have been in SQL Server for quite a while now. With SQL Server vNext, what's different? Why are we bringing this up now?
Previously, customers will have to set up a cluster to take advantage of these capabilities. Mm-hmm. And configuring, operating a cluster, it was a lot of manageability overhead if HA was not the goal.
Yeah, it's not super easy, that's for sure.
Exactly. Yep. And if the purpose is to offload the read-only workloads and increase the performance on the primary to have it run mission-critical workloads, then this is in SQL Server vNext, customer will be able to configure availability groups without any dependency on any cluster technology. Nice. So that brings me up to say that this solution is available both on Windows and Linux, mm-hmm. and customer can even use it today. It's in public preview, so they can try it out.
Nice. Okay. So the idea is if I want high availability and read scale, I use always-on availability groups with a cluster solution like Windows Server Cluster or Pacemaker. But if I don't really care about the high availability, I just use the of always on availability groups for replicas.
Without the cluster, you don't have an HA solution.
I see.
So if customers will want a HA, they will have to integrate with the cluster manager, Windows failover clustering on Windows, mm-hmm. and a cluster technology like Pacemaker on Linux.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. So can we see a demo of this?
Oh, definitely. Let's try it out.
All right, Mihaela, so I've got this application. It's got an OLTP part to it, and it's got an analytics part to it. And I'm excited to be able to take the analytics part and move that off to a read-only replica set of nodes for better scaling, and then that will also improve the performance of the mm-hmm. OLTP part of my application. So I've got a benchmarking tool that I use here to measure the throughput of the analytics part of this workload. So let's go ahead and set up an availability group, and then I'll launch the benchmarking tool against it, and we'll see how it goes.
Yeah, I already had set it up. It has three replicas, three secondary replicas. I created the availability group with the cluster type none. That means I don't have a cluster on top of it, mm-hmm. right? And if we look at the read-only routing list that I configured for the primary, it has at this time just one of the three secondary replicas in the list.
Okay.
So you can start your workload.
All right, let's start it.
And
so I'm going to add 20 or so connections to this availability group for now. And so as these are coming up and connecting, let's talk about what's going on the availability group side.
Definitely. So the connections will go to the primary, which will route them to the secondary replica that is configured at the primary replica.
Okay. Oh, so since we have one replica in the read-only routing list, all these connections are going to that one node, right? So this is sort of our baseline test of the throughput that we get on a single node. So what I'm seeing right now is that our transactions per second are typically around 6 per second right now. So let's go ahead and stop this particular test, and let's go ahead and add an additional replica, and then we'll run the test again.
Let's see. So if we add a second replica in the routing list, what will happen is that the primary will start routing the incoming connection to the two replicas in a round robin fashion. So we're going to have a load balancing among the two replicas. So let's just run it. We can see that the routing list was updated. I have two replicas now.
Okay.
In the list, you can just
start it again here. Okay. So here we go. We'll add the same 20 connections and see what happens. So this time, the connections are coming in, and the primary is sending them to one of the two nodes for each connection, so that it ends up being load balanced across the two.
Yeah, so in this, with the 20 connection, one replica will have 10 and the other 10, so it's
right.
Should be linear scaling.
Okay, perfect. All right, so we're almost there. We've got about 17 of them up now. Okay, so now all of them are connected, and it looks like we're getting a throughput on this at about 11 transactions per second. So like you said, almost double what we saw before, which is sort of what we would expect. Okay, so that's awesome. I can just keep adding replica nodes and scale my application up as needed. Sometimes with these analytics workloads, though, or read-only workloads in general, sometimes there's higher demand and lower demand depending upon the time of day or time of month even. So is there a way that I can add replicas into my routing list dynamically without having to stop my application, and it can just start spreading the load across even more nodes and then scale it back down automatically?
Definitely. So when you have, in your case, right, you're already running 20 connection, I'm going to add a fourth replica to the group, right? So it will have three secondary replicas right now. Mm-hmm. And any new incoming connections, it will start distributed among the three, not only two, right? So I'm just going to update it right now. So let's see. It's the simple alter command. And you can see there are three secondary replicas in the read-only routing list.
Okay.
You can increase the number of connections to simulate, you know, higher
right.
Workload demand.
So I'll add another 10 connections. So they're coming online now. And I didn't have to restart my application or anything. They're just getting connected. So can you see some of these new connections
exactly.
coming in now?
So now if we query the third secondary replica that we just added, we can see that it got three of the new connections, and they're running workload right
now. Nice. That's perfect. So this allows me to dynamically scale up and down the read part of my application depending on the demand.
Yeah, and when you scale down, these connections will continue running until they drain, you know, the workload is complete. So it's not going to cut.
Right, so you just kind of drain the connections over time if you need to spin it down. All right, great demo, Mahela. That was awesome to see that all in action. Can definitely see how this can help customers get better performance by offloading those read-only workloads. So if you're interested in trying this out for yourself, just go grab the latest SQL Server vNext CTP bits, starting with CTP 1.3. I think this has all been in there. And so just go grab whatever the latest release is that's out there now and install it, try it out. Let us know what you think. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.